there's incentives at this point. You can be competitive. It's an easy plug-in, the same technology. So yeah, I think wind is definitely the forerunner of all renewables. That's all.
Thank you. Questions from the audience, from participant members. Yes, Mr. Jackson. If it's to a particular panelist, feel free to address or the entire panel.
This is just going to refer back to you. You said that wind seems to be, in your opinion, seems to be the best method. And you also said that there's no byproduct from wind. And this isn't there's any harmful chemical byproduct or anything. But this is what I've read about wind energy. It does create some difficulties for the area, so it can create problems with more wind flow. Is that something that can be managed? Is that a concern? Does that still make a leading choice when the wind's going to be increased?
Yeah, good question. Yeah, basically some of the things we see that we start dealing with policy-wise and legislation, you can put it this way, the byproducts, which is what my interest is pollution, but the byproducts are less, but also these new things start popping up, like shadow casting, right? If you build these things in your houses, and the sun's in the right angle, then all of a sudden the person's looking out their window and just seeing, you know, repetitive blinking shadows outside. So they can actually sue the wind farm and have that turbine shut down. So, you know, we've actually gotten around some of those issues with using technology to analyze when the sun's in that position and then shut down the turbine for the hour that it's going to be over that person's house. So the shadow cast monitor will come by. It's $3,000. But then you don't have to shut the turbine down, which is $2 million, right? So we see these kind of odd considerations now with wind, but pollution's not one.
Can I make a point of earlier Sean was talking about it's competitive with coal. I think one of the things that has come out in the last decade or so is it's competitive with coal just on when you compare it head to head. But when you start including the cost of remediation and pollution that comes about because of other forms of these, it's not even close. Wind energy throughout most of the western U.S. is about half the cost of what coal should be if we actually force the coal manufacturers to pay for all the damage that they do. So, I know you're talking about the tax credits, but it makes sound like, oh, that's an unfair advantage. Well, coal already has an unfair advantage. That is, they put all their pollution out there and all that.
Right. So, using that going to the point where it's being controlled more so if the coal cost is more.
Yeah, as you put more of the clean burning coal technology on the coal burning plant, you expect the cost of coal to go up by at least a couple of cents a kilowatt.
I think we all know that the air, the turbines, it's a cleaner version, but I think the question was, are there any effects, wind effects that we know of? Was that your focus of your question, not the shadowing?
Oh, did I miss the mark?
That's okay. We have a couple more minutes.
Yeah, right. I've heard of complaints in, noise complaints from neighbors. I've heard complaints of shadow casting. The construction obviously interrupts the whole area. But I really haven't heard of the flow of air being increased or decreased. I mean, basically, you have a percentage of that, the amount of air that goes in, is used to turn the blades. It's actually a lot of that fuel is used. 30-40% of the energy that goes in is actually used. But if you think of it, it's just like a sail, right? It's going to go off the other side, maybe more turbulent, but we don't build them right on top of houses, so I don't see it as a major problem.
Thank you very much.
Okay,
sir.
Well, Arkansas's energy office puts out a guide that I think was referenced on the Facebook page called A Consumer's Guide to Renewable Energy in Arkansas. And it addresses all the different kinds of clean energy. And one of the things it recommends is that that you, if you're considering clean wind energy, that you should look into zoning issues, because in some cases the height of structures is restricted, and maybe even only to 35 feet. And also sometimes you need, you know, you need a building permit. And then in addition to the zoning requirements, your neighbors might object to a wind system that blocks their view, or they might be concerned about noise. And this guide says that most of the zoning and aesthetic issues, at least, I'm not that familiar with the wind effects, can be addressed by supplying some objective data, and that the ambient noise of most of the modern residential wind turbines is about 52 to 55 decibels. I'm not sure how that translates, but it says that this means that while the sound of the wind turbine can be picked out of surrounding noise, if a conscious effort is made to hear it, a residential-sized wind turbine is no noisier than your average refrigerator. I think some people just are also concerned about the effects on bird migrating patterns as well.
I think that is, that's a huge issue here for Arkansas State University. We have quite a number of research projects going on with birding. Nordics is familiar with that. It can be a bigger issue than we think. But let's continue with the discussion, and let's direct it towards the cost effectiveness of these facilities. We have, everybody understands that clean energy is a must, but the manufacturing of these large turbines, you said 100 meters, correct? The manufacturing of these large turbines, are there numbers that Nordex has on the breakfast to you again, sir, that will illustrate the cost effectiveness of the wind energy?
Yeah, I mean, I tend to hear numbers such as, you know, the production tax credit is cyclical, right? Basically, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but from what I understand, it's every other year. It has been every other year for quite a while. So, so you look at the cost effectiveness with and without that PTC. The PTC was only a few cents per kilowatt hour, but over, you know, 200 turbine farm. This runs for 25 years, it's quite a lot, quite a difference. Again, these turbines are, you know, about $3 million a piece. A farm of 200 of them, that is, you know, a lot of money. So the banks, usually these projects are bankrolled with huge loans from investors that look to get the money back. It takes about 5 years to get the money back on the turbine, but yet they run for 25 years. 20 years of almost pure profit, besides major malfunctions because the warranties run out. So it's actually quite a good investment for, you know, those who take the leap and take the plunge on that level. But yeah, if you compare it directly with some of these other sources, I think wind was around, I want to say 12 cents per kilowatt hour, 12 to 14. The last I checked, maybe a year ago. Then solar was upwards of 20 cents per kilowatt. So I mean, quite a difference. So when I focus on solar, I focus on the technology that would bring down the cost per kilowatt hour, so that it would be a viable investment. Does that address me?
Please feel free.
I'm going to keep touting this Consumer's Guide to Renewable Energy in Arkansas, available through the Arkansas Energy Office at arkansasenergy.org, because it lays out all of the different kinds of clean energy, potential costs and considerations that you need to take into consideration, and the advantages and disadvantages of each. And it is a consumer's guide, so it's not for industry, it's for you. And so I highly